Bouke, zijn er nog vragen binnengekomen?
Yes, we have one question.
One question.
About experiencing brotherhood. And the question is, if something happens to another that is unjust, and when you are touched about what happens, can you say that we unconsciously experience brotherhood at that moment? And then the question is, even though it may be on an emotional level, but if we are touched because injustice is done to somebody?
Yeah. Well, you know, and that is something I will address in my third block, but I can say a few words about it. If you are touched by it, that is the first thing. But we have to be critical, because we can touch by it because it hurt our feelings. Yeah, because we don't like to see what happens. Yeah. Or it can touch us because we don't want to do injustice to another person, and that is the reason we get that feeling. What I will make clear, I hope to make clear in the third block, the last block, is to say, okay, there is all justice to be touched, but the thing what you should do is not only be touched by it, but you should come to action from, let's say, compassion point of view. You share your knowledge and your power to help another in that particular situation. And that is much more important than just having the emotional side to be pity, have tears. And when we go on and you are one block further, the tears are away and the feeling is away, and we go on with the things we are still doing. Yeah. So that is an important thing, that the compassion means something much more, and I will do my best to make that more clear in the third block. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That also sounds more like that active brotherhood that came later in the purposes.
Yeah. The active brotherhood means something, be active, so touch by it. You can say that is already an activity, but it is not the activity we have in mind. The activity we have in mind, we have to stand up and we have to do something, yeah, for injustice and what happens to persons, etc., etc. Yeah.
And we have another question, an interesting one. When universal brotherhood is a fact in nature, why is it such a mess in the world now?
Yeah, it's a good one. Yeah. Well, that is the reason there is a Theosophical Society, and there is lectures, and there is this, and a lot of activities from, let's say, 1875 on, to make people aware of it. Because the fact is there, but like you can see in each family with a lot of brothers, the fact that there are brothers doesn't mean that they are living in harmony and are not fighting with each other. That can be still the case. So, let's say, the lower part in our thinking should be uplifted to become to the insight and the realization that we are brothers, and that it is not a way we have to deal with each other. We have to help each other. Yeah, and helping each other can best mean sometimes that you have to be tough, clear, direct, unpolished, saying what is really going on. Yeah, it's not always a matter of covering with nice feelings and nice words. No, helping can be holding up the mirror and showing other what the reason is that he has this problem, what type of knowledge is lacking, and what he has to do on that. Yeah.
I just see another question coming in. Universal brotherhood as a fact is also what we can find in great traditions when they speak. Oh yeah, when they speak, I'm my brother's keeper. Is that the same idea?
Yeah. Yeah, you know, that is one of the questions that expression is coming from the Bible. So, I am my brother's keeper, or is it my responsibility to take care of my brother? If you come from the Theosophical idea with the total oneness and integration, yes, we have a responsibility there. Of course, everybody is having free will, so he can always deviate from the idea of brotherhood and do something absolute against it. But in principle, we should always try to help each other to keep them on the line of cooperation, harmony, and growing and training together.
Okay, that is it for now. Yeah.
Fine. Thank you, Bauke. Okay, then we go to the fundamental unity. We have already seen that in the objectives, quite often there is a line, let's say, study the Eastern philosophies and study this and study that. And why is that? Because in a lot of sources in the Eastern traditions, like Buddhism, but also in, let's say, the Tao Te King from Lao Tse, but also in Hinduism and so on and so on, in the fundamental ideas of that traditions, there is oneness, Islam, the all, Allah, oneness, yeah? Everything is belonging there. We are one in principle with each other. So what I like to explain now in the coming part, in the coming 20 minutes or so, is that Blavatsky make very clear on which, let's say, principle this is the case. And what I will show you is the fundamental principles, the propositions of the Second Doctrine. And of course, I have to express it and I have to speak about it in intellectual words and phrases, but it is not so much in trying to give you an intellectual motivation to come to the conclusion that there is universal brotherhood, but it is more trying to help you in developing the insight, the Buddhic point of view, the overall point of view, that you start to see that we have to deal really with a oneness. Yeah? And that oneness is by Blavatsky expressed very well in the Second Doctrine, in the first part, in the proem, in the first propositions, and later on nog further expressed in the Second Doctrine. Then, of course, the Second Doctrine was published already in 1888, so that is quite, let's say, along the line of bringing out all the knowledge. But I think in the Second Doctrine you find it the most clear, and we go over it, and I hope to make it for you clear as well. The one first proposition, you know, a proposition is just a statement, and you have to study this for yourself. We have already tried to explain this in our symposium, what is called the theory of everything. And the last one is independent search of truth, is that how do you deal with propositions? The Second Doctrine proposed an idea and we have to justify it, to investigate it for ourselves. And it is a very abstract one. And it is very good to realize that it is a very abstract one. If it is not abstract, then it can be very limited in its value. But in the abstraction, and it runs as follows. One, an omnipresent, eternal, boundless, immutable principle on which all speculation is impossible, since it is transcends the power of the human conception, and could only be drafted by any human expression or stimulant. It is beyond the range and reach of thoughts, in the words of the Manjuka, unthinkable, unspeakable. One absolute reality which antecedents all manifestations and conditions and conditions and beings. So there is, and that is something what is hard to express in words, especially in Western terms, there is something what is fundamental to everything. And everything is part of the immutable principle. Everything belongs to it. Everything has as a source the immutable principle that is present in us all. So, and what you can say abridged is something like infinite or boundless. And that is a concept, if you start thinking about it, that is really far-reaching. Because infinite and boundless means also that everything was there already. that everything is not created, but is there, and that all things what runs from this is just manifested himself. But it is not a matter of creating out of nothing. No, it is there. In principle, it is there. Yeah. So if you see the keywords, is the omnipresent, eternal, boundless, immutable. Immutable, that means it is not changing. That principle is omnipresent. It is boundless. It is always there. And then the second proposition in the secret doctrine runs on base of the first one. And then we speak about eternity of the universe in toto as a boundless plane. Periodical, the playground of numberless, universal, incessant manifestations and disappearance, called the manifesting stars and the sparks of infinity. Sparks of infinity. Keep in mind, the eternal of the pilgrim is like a wink of the eye of self-existence. The appearance and disappearance of worlds is like a regular tidal ebb or flux or reflux. Cyclic motion, periodical appearance and disappearance of galaxies. So, the sparks of infinity, the eternity of the pilgrim, that are keywords in this one. Because sparks of infinity, a spark is coming from a fire, and we know a spark makes itself, release itself from the fire. Yeah? And name a distance. What we try here to say, this is impossible, because the other one is infinite, immutable. So you cannot take something off, you cannot something add, everything is there. But we have to phrase words to try to explain to us that there happens something in that infinite and in that omnipresent, immutable. Yeah? And Blavatsky called this sparks, yeah, of eternity, the pilgrim. And then there is a very small star. And now in the footnote, she comes back on that idea and say, pilgrim is the application given to our monad, the two in one, during a cycle of incarnations. Yeah, it is the only immortal, eternal principle in us, being an indivisible part of the integral whole, the universal spirit, from which it emanates and into which it is absorbed at the end of a cycle. So the second proposition speaks about a number of very important things. The second speaks about cyclicity, yeah, and speaks about the pilgrim, the monad. And the whole idea of monads, I will address it a little bit later, is something very important. That means in the infinite something, immutable something, you can say, and that is just my words, and I have to use words for make it a little bit more clear, that there are contractions, let's say, flows, vertexes. There is something in it what gives a little bit the idea that it starts to express itself. Yeah? So, and say, she say, when it is said to emanate from the one spirit, an awkward and incorrect expression has to be used for lack of appropriated words in English. Oftewel, we have no good words for this. Because we are not trained in our Western culture to think about something like infinite, immutable, and so on, and still see some activity in it. Yeah? If something is infinite, you cannot say it is static, because something what is static is not by definition infinite. So there is motion all over, yeah, as part of it. And then you go on in the third one, the fundamental identity of all souls, of the universal oversoul, yeah, the later being itself an aspect of the unknown root, and the obligatorial pilgrims for every soul, a spark of the former, throughout the cycle of incarnation or necessity, in accordance with cyclic and karmic laws during the whole terms. The fundamental equality or every being with the boundless. So that means that we are all in fundamental idea the same. We have to go to the cyclic periods. Yeah. The necessity is there. Yeah. We have to go through there. And I myself can only make it more clear to say, okay, infinite incorporated in something is always trying to explode, to express itself, because you cannot put infinite in something what is limited. That means there is a pressure, there is something what likes to go out. And that is what she tries to say here, is that the monad, the spark of infinity, is always trying to manifest what he is in principle. So the doctrine of the monad, of the monads, is a very important one. And it is very fundamental in understanding the theosophical teachings and principles. Yeah? The monad means, and you find the word monads also back in other traditions. We find it back in, what is it, in Leibniz is using it. The Greeks were using it. Pythagoras was was using the monad idea. And you find it back in many traditions, not always with the word monad, but well with the same, let's say, meanings. Yeah? So a monad meaning an indivisible center of life consciousness substance, a spiritual ego, you can call it. Yeah. But keep in mind, the limitations we know in the words ego is not, let's say, addressable on the idea of monad. Yeah? Each monad has the same infinite faculties within it. Monads are not at the same stage of expression their infinite faculties. So one monad is further than the other one. They are named after the states they are in expressing which quality. So in our literature, we speak about human monads, divine monads, animal monads. In principle, monads are like monads. And let's say, to call it human, divine, or animal, is just saying this monad is just in the states of expressing human quality, or is only in the state of expressing animal qualities. Yeah. So, and that is what we do, yeah? The divine, human, animal, astral, yeah? Every being, yeah, is an hierarchical cooperation of an infinite group of monads. That is something complete strange to our Western way of thinking. We say, I am, yeah, that's me. And we don't realize that we are composed out of a huge amount of monads. That every thought we have, you can see that as a monad, cooperating with us, sticking to us for a longer or shorter period. Yeah. So every being is the hierarchical cooperation. So we are composed of million and million of monads. If you take your human body, each cell is a monad. Yeah. Each atom is a monad. Yeah. So, and that all works together by an overhaving influence, a type of, let's say, sticking them together and keep them in a type of cooperation. So no one can exist without cooperation with all the million other monads. So everything is composed. Hierarchical structure. And it is done on basis of attraction. We call it quite often emanation, because emanation is something what say a little bit more. That means that from the top monad, the tetractus, the top in the tetractus, the top monad, sends out a type of atmosphere. Yeah? And that attracts other monads, what likes to be in cooperation with the one who sends this emanation. And then starts the cooperation, what we can call evolution. We work together, we learn from each other, we learn to express our inner qualities, and so on, and so on. And that idea of emanation, you can find many, many very nice examples in all Buddhist sutras, how that is working, yeah. Keep in mind that in all that spheres from the cooperation, there is a balance between spirit and substance. In theosophy, we don't know a difference between spirit and substance. Substance is only a word what we use for monads in a lower state of evolution, what looks to us as very static, not much activity in it, yeah, like we call it sometimes matter, and we think that is what the science is called dead matter. No, we say, it don't exist, dead matter. It is always monads, it is always spirit, and spirit and substance is just a way of addressing the level of activity and, let's say, the level of expression, what they do. Yeah. So everything is consciousness and is alive. And now we come to something what is important, that from the foregoing we can now conclude that universal brotherhood is in fact in nature. Because if we see the first proposition, what is in eternal, infinite, yeah, immutable, that everything is already belonging to there, everything is in fact one, that we can conclude from this, let's say, deeper philosophical ideas, that there is a oneness, that there is a universal brotherhood, that we are interrelated, that we always have influence on each other, that my action will act on all these cells in my body, but also in principle in all my human fellow men as well, in the same society, but over the whole world, yeah, it will run. Yeah. And nowadays, with all the modern communications, it is much easier to see for yourself that if we do something here, it will have effect of have over there. Yeah. So this has this a deep philosophical background, a deep religion meaning. Yeah. And everything is interconnected to everything. So that is the fundamental proposition, what is really the basis, not only the intellectual basis, but if you start to think about the whole totality, then you can easily see that there is a fundamental oneness. Yeah? And you can say, sounds nice, but keep in mind that Theosophia, yeah, thus that means the wisdom of the gods, is discovered and verified all over many thousands of generations of wise men. Yeah? And it is all tested, it is all expressed, it is all studied between the wise men and so on. So what we see nowadays in, for instance, the theosophical literature coming from Blavatsky and further on, is that it is tested. And it is our own responsibility om to test it for ourselves as well. Yeah? But keep in mind, if you start to look around and see, can I test it and verify it for myself within my scope of consciousness? Yeah? That you are not the only one. But we have also explained in our independent search of true symposia, if you want to grow in consciousness, you have to verify it for yourself. Just saying, oh, that is nice, say, and I believe, that is not make you 1 millimeter more wiser. You have to look around and say, okay, if everything is once, and yes, do I see this within my scope of consciousness? Can I see the cyclic activities? It's a very easy one to investigate. You can see it all over. You can say all life is almost, let's say, always running by cyclic activities. If you look in the cosmos, if you look in the Milky Way, if you look in the human body, if you look in our daily activities and so on, it is easy to incorporate. And the third one is, if you look carefully, then you see that each being, each consciousness, has in principle the same opportunities, the same principle possibilities. Yeah, that is, as above, so below. Yeah, and of course there is free will. So this on the lower levels, you see a lot of deviations. But if you look very carefully, you can see that the underlying, let's say, conduct and activities is all related to the three fundamental principles. Yeah. So, and that is the way we have to go for ourselves and to train ourselves. So, I hope this was not too much intellectual. I hope I was able to give also a Buddhic interview to show you something very hard to express in words of a totality, what is one huge cooperation of monads, and still is one. So this is the end of block 2. We have 3 minutes breaks. You can send your questions. I will address them first, and then we will go over to the third block. Nice. Hi. Okay, Bunker. Do we have some questions?
Yeah, we have two questions, and one I just missed from the first block still, and that is, why was and is universal brotherhood so important for the foundation of the Theosophical Society?
Yeah, you know, and that is a very principal, a very fundamental question. It is really the foundation of everything, you can say. And I try to explain it, because in the beginning there were some people, they found all the teachings of Brodsky very nice, and oh, you can do this with it, and how can we do change color of this, and how can we create this, and so on and so on. And so, well, the masters, as their chef, the Mahajogon, makes very clear, if we are not able to develop an inner sense for, let's say, brotherhood, universal oneness, you can never grow from spiritual point of view to higher levels. So they make very clear that you need to train yourself, not only, oh yes, I understand and I have to see it as universal. Nay, we have to become, because in theosophy, and special in the side what is called occultism, if you want to know the laws of nature and you want to respect them and you want to work with them for the profit of humanity, then you should have the right discipline, and then you should be universal. That means you cannot be a Buddha if you have not the feeling that you are, let's say, for... you have to work for the totality. So the fundamental idea of spreading theosophy in 1875 was not making the world known with all the funny laws and all the manipulations you can do with material things and beings, etc., etc. No, the fundamental principle the organization started, like it has done many times in the past as well, yeah, with all the different incarnations of the same teachings, is to make clear that we have to understand the totality, because we are the totality. Yeah. So, and that is a fundamental thing. So that is not a very nice side idea, universal brotherhood. No, no. It is the fundamental idea. Because if you're not take in account the fundamental idea of brotherhood, that means that the first fundamental principle is not, let's say, applicable for you. Yeah, you see yourself as a part, separated from the rest. No, we are one. And that is on what we have to understand. Second, we have to realize that if we want to have harmony, we should try to build harmony for the totality, because partly harmony is not enough, because everybody likes to live in harmony and in peace. So that means we have to work for the totality. So it is a fundamental principle. And I say it already in one of the Mahatma letters, the Mahatma is saying, okay, if you guys step away from this, we stop with a complete society. So it was not a matter we stop with the branches or with the groups here or with the groups there. No, we stop with the complete society. Because this is a proof, if people don't want this, is this is a proof that humanity is not ready to receive the higher teachings, how the universe is running and working. Yeah, because then the only thing what will coming from it is pain, war, fight, discriminations all over. And that is not what we want to see in the world. Yeah. So this is a very fundamental idea. And quite often people forget it, because we start to teach, study the teachings like all the rounds and races and karma and reincarnations and second incarnation and third incarnation and what happens in Kamaloka. But it is all a matter to understand the totality. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And next question is, you talked about the three propositions, and the question is the unknown root that is mentioned in the third. Is that the same as the principle in the first proposition?
Yeah, true. What you can see in the three propositions, the first one is the most abstract one. And then in the other ones, she starts also to speak about the spark of infinity. You know, that is already something. That is something, let's say, first propositions minus something. Yeah, she speaks about the soul. That is also, let's say, a type of manifestation from the first fundamental principles, from the first one. Yeah. So she used step for step words, the monad. She tries to explain that the monad in principle represents the first propositions, but try to express itself, make himself known by certain qualities. Yeah, that means limited, has to grow, is not steady, yeah, is not already expressing the first proposition. So, and then you can see that we have to use words. A human being, yeah, fundamental, a monad, have everything in him, but we call him human. Why? Because he, we are only to express human qualities. So, and there you see that happens all the time, that the partly manifestations get a name and will be addressed by that limited expressing name, the limited expressing quality name. Yeah.
So oversoul in that third proposition already gives an idea of something being even bigger.
So that means a monad, what is so high in our point of view that it is overhaving, over controlling, inspiring a lot of other monads. Exactly the same what we humans do. We know, we don't realize that we as human beings do exactly the same. Our thinking, our emotions, our spiritual enlightenments are influences to all the monads, what we call cells, yeah, and organs and atoms. We have all, let's say, cooperated in our body.
Cooperation within cooperation.
And very dynamic.
The next question about expressing a universal brotherhood is, could we think that the best advancement and example today of universal brotherhood is represented by social conscience of the NGOs? In all fields?
That is for me a little bit of a tricky question, because I have respect for a lot of NGOs, but we know all that NGOs are, let's say, exist by human beings. They run it, they organize it, and I cannot make a statement that all dead beings are really 100% brotherhood people in the theosophical definition of the words. Yeah, I hope they are, and I hope they will be in the future. So, and again, a lot of people, NGOs, I have quite a real amount of respect, but we know it is not always 100%, let's say, perfect, yeah? Mm-hmm. Yeah? We have the same situation, I say it already, we have Gandhi with his activities for the Hindu caste and the different type of people over there, the what is it called, the pariahs, etc., etc. Blavatsky was already many years before working on it. And that is not something what you can find so easily, because it was all, let's say, more or less done on a level in India, what was not giving much attention by the British newspapers, etc., etc. Although he was quite much involved in that type of thing. Annie Besant, another well-known theosophist, was very active in India and has done a lot of good things for the complete Indian society. Yeah.
And the following question of the same person is, in your opinion, how far have we advanced in fraternity since HPB? And what are the most necessary steps to continue advancing towards brotherhood in general and in theosophical sense?
Yeah, well, you know, that is in complex the question. I try to explain why. You know, people incarnated in the time of Blavatsky, yeah, they learn the lessons from Blavatsky and Willem Kontiorts and all the people supporting Blavatsky. So they, let's say, they grow, but they die. And their incarnation interval is a few thousand years. So the people nowadays, very unlikely that we are incarnated in the time of Blavatsky. So we have to learn our lessons from what the first, let's say, level of theosophists were putting on paper. Yeah, we can study that papers and all the documents. We have to learn from that. We have to study together. And we have to learn our lessons on this moment. That is, I hope we take it with us. We take another, let's say, incarnating cycle, let's say 2,000 years. So, and so goes on. So it will take another few thousand years before the first, let's say, incarnated people from the time of Blavatsky will be reincarnated again. Yeah, except the one, and that are very few, and that is what I'd like to address in the second part, except the few what are so much motivated from a compassion point of view, that they don't want to have a long reincarnation. They are satisfied by 10, 20, 30 years and like to be reincarnated again, because they have the urge in themselves to spread this information to help humanity.
So there might maybe some great impulses and steps, but we don't see them yet.
Yeah.
They are, yeah.
Now that will be work out in the future. Mm-hmm. It is very likely that we are much more the people coming from the time of, let's say, Plato. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Or from the time of Gautama the Buddha or something like that. Yeah. And if you look how popular Plato is in the West on the moment, you can, let's say, that is really giving an indication that the people, let's say, recognize themselves in the literature of Plato. Yeah.
I see one more question, and that is, what is going wrong that every religion has made the ones a god or gods and not in universal brotherhood? If they don't, that make the world a better place to live. I think it's about the ideas of the monads. I don't know. Maybe we'll ask the questioner to ask it again for after this third block.
Yeah. Well, maybe as a general idea that maybe will help is that we have to realize that the Theosophia, yeah, the wisdom of the gods have seen in the past many, many incarnations in all different type of culture. And what happens all the time, and that is in a certain way pity, is that people start to study it. And if they pass it on, they pass it not on in the purity as it is given. They give their own interpretation with it and so on. It is very difficult to speak about this type of subject. Maybe you noticed that I myself feel myself in the explanation of the monads and how that works, let's say, more handicapped than that I say, okay, well, this is something what I can easily express and so on, because it is a very difficult something. So I have to refer to the sources. Study yourself. What I am saying is trying to help you. But please check what I'm saying and see if the original publications help you to understand it on a deeper way. And that is what we always have to do. Yeah? Even the most inspiring information from Gautama the Buddha. Nowadays, you see people doing something and acting according to their interpretation of the teaching of the Buddha, where you can easily say, that is never said by the Buddha, but they do their own, follow their own interpretation. And that is something what we should not do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I now realize the oneness is meant in the question. Yeah. Why the oneness became a person.
Yeah.
And then lose the idea of this unity and this brotherhood that we all are together. Yeah.
Yeah, with all the respect I have for the Islam, the all is really the all. Mm-hmm. So there is, in fact, if you're you are thinking and you study according to that line, there is no exception. Everybody is belonging to it. So you should have respect for everybody who belongs to it. Yeah?
Okay, that were the questions for now.
Okay. Let's say, try to... Thank you.